This is a Choppin' It Up show brought to you by the Marching Podcast. And now here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Welcome to the Choppin' It Up show. I'm your host, Joe Beard. Happy to be of service for you. Today is, November the 15th, I think, 2020, 3 o'clock on the West Coast and 6 o'clock on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live, whether through iTunes, YouTube, our blog, Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, Periscope, or wherever you are on the interwebs. This podcast is brought to you by Block Band Music and Publishing, BlockUsUp.com, SAY Marketing and Promotions, Kevin Peete of Remax Patriots, Math-Sci Tutoring and Educational Services, Bull City Music School, and Sofia's Fish and Barbecue, and Lamik's Videos. All right, shout out to our sponsors. Let me just give a quick round of applause for our sponsors. So we always got a great guest, you know what I'm saying, every time we start the show. But this guest is near and dear to my heart because I wanted to be this dude when I was in school. And I'm kind of already kind of letting the cat out the bag about where he went to school. But today we chopping it up with the one and only Tony Caldwell. How you doing in this podcast, sir?
Man, God is good. I'm happy to be with you. How you doing today?
I'm doing all right, So today we're going to talk to Tony about all he's been through, where he's from, and what he's doing today, our usual thing. And like I said, let the cat out the bag, but Tony Marsh and the great Sonic Boom of the South, round of applause. The Boom, the greatest band in the galaxy. And so definitely we'll talk about some of his experiences and some of my experiences. And since we marched together, meshing of the two. So shout out to all the alumni out there watching. I saw a lot of y'all responded about checking out the show today. So it was good to see a lot of your faces. And also, it'll be really good to, get this conversation out the way. So first what we're going to do, we'll take our first commercial break, give our shine to our beloved sponsors, and then after that, we'll dip right in and get into chopping it up with Tony Caldwell. All right, so we'll mute our microphones here, and then we'll get through with the first commercial break. You're chopping it up on the Marching Podcast Radio Network with Tony Caldwell. We'll be right back.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
The source for fair and factual information on your favorite college bands, blockusup.com. Well-written articles, in-depth band performance analysis, helpful resources for band directors, fun band-related topics, and exclusive interviews with some of today's brightest and most talented leaders of college marching bands. Visit us at blockusup.com, the meeting place for band fans and band directors.
Hello, everyone. This is Joe Beard from the Marching Podcast. Is your school, club, or organization looking for high-quality decorated apparel to outfit your students, staff, club, or team? Tired of the same old boring white t-shirt? Are you in charge of the upcoming fundraiser or special event, but don't really have time to troll the internet for ideas or compare products? SAY can help with design and product selection. We can even assist with ideas on conducting an effective fundraising program. SAY can help you save time and get your message heard. So call 1-800-975-3156. SAY Marketing and Promotions.
Give your brand a voice.
If you're thinking about buying or selling real estate in the Southern California area, please contact Kevin Peete of Remax Patriots. He will meet and exceed all of your needs. You can contact Kevin at 951-858-5942. That's 951-858-5942. Or you can email Kevin at kpsaleshomes@sbcglobal.net. That's KP, his initials, Kevin Peete, KP Sales Homes, all one word, at sbcglobal.net. Thanks again.
And it's your boy Brandon.
And Javante.
And we the Rogers Bros. And you rocking with my man Joe Beard.
For the Marching Podcast.
Yeah.
Hello, this is Jamie Barnett, California educator, graduate of Cal State University at Long Beach, Chi Beta Chapter, Spring 98, Q-Sci-5. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hello, this is Dr. Martin Rex Kedziora. I am the Chief Academic Officer for the Moreno Valley Unified School District. I'm a graduate of the University of Laverne, where I received my doctorate degree. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
All right, we're back, and you can unmute your microphones. Ready to chop it up here with Tony Caldwell. We used to just call him Caldwell back in the day. That's Caldwell right back in the day. So let's go ahead and get right into it. Tony, where are you from, man?
Man, I'm from Ken, Mississippi. You know, that's about 35, maybe 40 miles outside of Jackson, north.
Okay. All right. Now, are your folks, your family, all of them from Canton too?
Born and reared, yes. My mom and my father both from the country parts of Canton, Mississippi. As you can tell from a southern drawl, proud to be from the country.
That's all right. That's all right. That's what's up, man. So I always ask the folks this, and plus you was in the band, so, you know, it's a little bit easier for the for the interview to go. But what would you say was your first exposure to music? Like, what was your first instrument, or when did you know that you wanted to start playing an instrument?
Like I said, man, I grew up out in the country, and, you know, I went to church. And, you know, I listened to the choir, and I didn't sing in the choir at a really, really early age, especially before I found Christ. But I could groove with the choir, and I would find myself on my way to church trying to remember the words to the newest songs, or, you know, just make sure that I could go over the words for the songs that I already knew. So right. It was really in church where I found out that music was my backbone.
Okay. And then at the same time, you being, you know, from Mississippi and not too far from Jackson, when would you say your first exposure to HBCU marching bands came in?
Well, I have a cousin, and his name is Curtis Caldwell. Curtis' crab name was Egg Monkey. he was KKSI, and, you know, he was a DJ. So he brought all that home to the country on the weekend. You know, through the week, he was getting ready for the weekend, even when he got out of college. Mm-hmm. So that's why I really fell in love. Actually, I had a love for KKSI before I found out about the sci-fi.
Wow.
You know, that's no lie. You know, one of my first introductions to college was that organization.
Okay, that's interesting to know, because I didn't know nothing about it. Me being from St. Louis, it wasn't that same band love like that.
Yeah.
When I went to Smith first, before I came to Jackson State, that's when I found out about KKSI. But what's funny is, and of course, already I know a lot of folks was already seeing that, you know what I'm saying, you a member of the great Omega Sci-Fi Fraternity Incorporated.
That's right.
You know, what's funny about that is the KKSI dudes in North Carolina, when I don't know if you've seen this, but they be throwing it up like the bros. Have you ever seen that?
I've not seen it.
Yeah. You got to see it. But they had their fingers out, but then they be turning it up, you know what I'm saying, around their head. And I was like, damn, that look like the bros, you know what I'm saying? But that's how they do it over there.
Yeah.
But that's what's up, man. So you had the exposure then to KKSI. And I guess KKSI, they had been out for a minute at Jackson State, right?
Yeah, KKSI is prominent, you know, along with every HBCU, but particularly at JSU because of War and Thunder. You know, people love the drum section, and he was a percussionist, but his primary instrument in the band was the snare drum. So, you know, he was always practicing, you know. It was really curiosity. Okay. It was a good curiosity, though.
Right.
I didn't even know about the sci-fi until I came to college, honestly. Like I said, I'm a country boy. I knew I wanted to go to college because I wanted to achieve some things, you know, greater or different from what I was exposed to for the most part. And exposure. You never know who you're going to touch when you're around.
Right.
That's one of the lessons that I learned in Canton. A whole lot of the things about who I am today actually came from curiosity, being exposed to people who had seen a few things different from the ones most frequently by the people where I grew up.
That's interesting. That's an interesting point, because I know that kind of ties into like your career and all the stuff like that. I definitely will probably bring that point back up.
Gotcha.
Once we get a little bit later over there. Okay, so curiosity, like you say. What high school then did you go to while you were there in Canton?
Canton High.
Canton.
of course, Canton High School, man. I had to pick an elective when I got to the school, and I had a love for music, and I picked the band. And I found out which instruments you didn't have to put a stress on your parents to pay for. You know, my father had already gone on. He passed when I was 3. So I didn't want to put any financial burden on my mom. So I found out that you could play the baritone, you could play the tuba, you could be a percussionist. And I think he had a few saxophones there that you could play. And I picked the tuba. And, of course, you pay your little deposit and you go from there. You know, I could wrap that horn around my body, you know, and It was trouble for who was across on the other side of the field, you know, when I learned how to play that horn.
It's funny because I always hear people say that, like, they basically were going to find out, you know, the easiest instrument or the best instrument for them to play, you know, when they're in school. So you picked tuba. Okay. Now, what grade were you in? Did you start playing right when you were in high school, or did you play, like, a couple years before high school?
No, when I got to high school, man, again, what I experienced, you know, the bad parts, I want to make sure my children have experienced. I grew up in the country, and my father had, you know, like I said, he passed, and I couldn't get to Canton and compete against a lot of the people and a lot of the sports that I wanted to play, and I had all this athleticism balled up, so I could make a team, but I couldn't be that guy on the team, and I wanted to be that guy on the team. But I found out in track, you know, you could practice by yourself and you could be that guy without the team concept. And I found out in the band, even though band is a collective now, the band is not a good band if the individual members of the band are not dedicated. Right. And I was dedicated at being good. So when I found out how to play the horn, particularly when I found out how to project on the horn, you know, I let the world know about it.
Okay. That's what's up. So Canton, did they march? And I know as the
stop it, just stop it, man. Canton is the baby boom of the South.
Okay, all right.
There is no competition. There is no other school that can say that name under Jesse Primer when he was there, and now under Marquise Smith. Even though Marquise went to Alcorn, he is the Bruz, and you know he is representing. There's only one baby boom of the South. There's only one Sonic Boom of the South.
Yeah. Cause you know it's hella schools trying to be like the boom. I mean, outside of Mississippi too.
Yeah, they should.
Right. So that's what's up, man. So yeah, of course. So you guys marched swag style and all that. Was there ever a time that y'all marched like core, like heel toe, to do like competitions or anything like that?
Oh yeah, of course. You know, we were never the best at that. Because again, you have to have people with an interest in a certain kind of music or a certain style of band. If you live close to Jackson, Mississippi, if you've ever been exposed to the Sonic Boom of the South and you have an interest in the band, you want to march in a band that's trying to emulate something close to what they're doing.
Right.
So what made me want to march in a band was high knee, low back, you know, heel. I want to march high knee. I don't want to march core style, but of course, in order to get a scholarship to a prestigious band like Jackson State, you have to be exposed to all that.
Right.
So Jesse Primer ran a real program, you know. And even in the off season, we worked on improvs.
Okay.
He was that kind of band director, and he wanted you to play different kinds of instruments just to say that you had exposure to them. So, yeah, we need those kind of people, and Jackson State produced those kind of people, particularly during the time when we were marching in the band. A lot of leaders came out of that squad, man.
Mm-hmm. That's like real.
Like the 96 NBA draft, it was like that during that time. You know, a lot of people came out of Jackson State and went straight into the communities and started doing great things.
Right. And I actually learned that when I got to Jackson, where the actual music programs in the surrounding areas was like really, really good, because, you know, like you said, that exposure, but just musicality in general, you know what I'm saying? That was just huge for that surrounding area. I had a couple of cousins. One of my cousins went to Provine, and then I had two cousins that went to Callaway. They actually marched in the marching band.
Okay.
So they were really good players on the horn. So I was like, well, damn, how are y'all so good? Like, but yeah, them programs out there, they were really good.
There's a lot of people competing for those jobs. Like, think about it. Every year that a person who went to a JPS school that comes out of a Jackson State program when it deals with music, I'm pretty sure they have some kind of arrogance or some kind of aspiration to say that if I had an opportunity to hold a position that this band director right here has, I would do this. So if you are already the band director, you have to stay on your toes and always move forward, you know, and build the program because you always have someone watching. That's the way I feel about my wife. I try to tell people, you know, it's a wife still married, man. How everything going so well. So I'm always thinking that the next guy's waiting for me to slow down and relax.
That's dope. Can't do that. I also want to say what's up to the chat room. People in the chat room always make the show all the time. And we got the one and only Casey Nesbitt up in there. And she said, what's up, Caldwell?
No, what's up, Casey?
Yeah. So shout out to her.
I love that girl.
Yeah, man. She funny.
Chi-Town, stand up.
I know. She funny. I didn't know like she was as silly as she was until like now. But I actually interviewed her a couple years ago before I did the video. Yeah.
Casey, she's wonderful, man.
Yeah, that's what's up. So, yeah, appreciate you checking us out, Casey. And also, if anybody else, you guys on the chat room, you guys jump in there. If you have any questions for Caldwell, go ahead and put them in the chat room and I'll read it to them. All right. So, you at Ken, like you said, the baby boom. Now, I know Jackson State was on your radar, you know, being so close. Did you know that you wanted to go to Jackson State, or did you have a list of schools that you were going to pick from when it was time to decide to where you wanted to go to college?
No, it was always Jackson State. And I had options. I had options to go to other schools, you know. I was academically proficient, you know, kind of a well-rounded student. But I wanted to stay close to home, to be close to where my mom was, God rest her soul. And, you know, it was always Jackson State.
Okay. All right. So that's what's up. So now, because I definitely wanted to get into, you were part of a special class. A lot of people don't know this. I mean, we know it. But you graduated high school in 94?
Correct.
Okay. So that would then lead you on to be a crab of 94, as they call it, or the great class of 94.
That's right.
Now, most people don't know, and I mean, we know, but 94, I mean, even when I was there, because when I got there, you guys were in your fourth year, I believe. Some unbelievable musicians, but overall, like a lot of good people, and a lot of good people that's out there, like doing good things as yourself out in the real world. But people don't know you guys outnumbered the upperclassmen. Is that right?
That is an accurate account.
So how many of y'all was it?
We made up 2/3 of the band. That was a transition. A lot of people stopped working on, I guess, musicianship. And this is just what we were told. So we're going to assume that it was true, and whether it was true or not, the actions were that they got rid of everyone else in the band to make room for us. So they were whitewashing the band and bringing in upperclassmen who held on to the right traditions, but kind of withstood what they would identify, you know, what leadership would identify as bad tradition. But they were wrong. They did keep the best musicians, and they did keep the people who were politically correct. But the good thing about it is those people understood what I understand. And what I love about my HBCU and most of them is you earn everything that you get. Of course, rituals and traditions needed to be corrected and made in safer manners. But whether they're verbal or physical, I still believe that a person, when I say physical, I think that it's okay for you to run a little harder if you're out of shape and you're trying to march in a band where physical fitness is paramount. You know, you need to be able to pick your legs up, and you need to be able to rigorously drive them down in front of you while you're moving forward and playing an instrument.
Right.
You can't expect a person who has not done any real physical activity as far as cardio and as far as upper body strength, if you're playing a tuba or carrying a drum, there's no nice way to tell you that you won't make it if you don't go a certain mile to become a part of it. And in 94, the group of freshmen that came together, we all wanted that. There was not an understanding. understanding that we were coming in to be something different from what the boom was before us. That was the last thing that we wanted. We did not want, and we made the upperclassmen who, you know, who were there with us, we made them understand, you know, we understand that we outnumber you, but we don't know how to march in the boom. We know how to march in a band.
Right.
You got to show us that. And so when they understood that we wanted it more than they wanted to give it to us, that was a mutual respect. And things just went in the right direction. And I think it was a great year. It was like a byproduct year. They didn't expect, they were expecting great results, but they were expecting different results. It came out with greatness nonetheless. And I'm happy to be a part of it. I'm proud to be a part of that class.
It's pretty much settled. That's like one of the greatest classes in boom history. You know what I'm saying? Like, not because of the sheer numbers themselves, but I mean, it was just a lot of good people, man. Like, when I came in 97, like, y'all were still deep. Like, it was a whole bunch of like 94 people still in the band. But man, I was just, I mean, mostly, you know what I'm saying, leaders or just people that was, you know, some, I mean, just people that was funny. You know what I'm saying? It was
a special. Listen, man, a band member is a student athlete. And the class of 94 was filled with student first athletes. You know, like you said, when you came in 97, we were still deep. It was because people came to get degrees. You know, and you had families waiting on you. You had hometowns that you didn't want to disappoint or you didn't want to make proud, because there's some people that's always wanting you to fail. And they're sitting at home hoping you come back home
right.
Without a degree or without a trade or without the experiences that move you to the next level. And we didn't want to give that to them.
Yeah, man. I just remember that. And I think that had a lot to do with the type of band we had in 97. Because I thought we was cold in 97.
97 was a cold year.
Yeah, buddy. So, you know, that's something I'm definitely proud of. But, I mean, we had leaders.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We had a lot of good leaders.
97 had a great line of Omega Psi Phi members to come out. And they had a tail dog, a guy at the end of the line that was, you know, he really wasn't playing around back there, you know, under any circumstances, you know, there's no level of scrutiny. Hey, but that's another story. Go ahead, what you're talking about.
Because, I mean, that's what I knew, and just kind of getting ahead of myself a little bit. That's what I learned, what the cues were. From that line. I mean, I knew some people that were older, some folks that were still, like, around the yard. But that's what I was saying earlier, man. Like, I knew after I met you, after I saw you, I was like, man, I'm trying to be like Tony. You know what I'm saying? Because you was tall, you was slim. And you'll say that's just like me. I was like, man, I'm trying to be like him. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What's funny is the time I met you, or the time, I don't even know if you remember this, but it was at Keon's house. You know, shout out to Keon. Player 94. Shout out to you. I was you was on the phone, and you had a purple polo jacket. I don't know if you remember that. It was purple, and the little horse was like darker purple. You know what I'm saying? And you was on the phone, and I was like, "What's up, Caldwell?" You know what I'm saying? You was like, "What's up?" You know what I'm saying? I was like, "What's up, Caldwell?" You know what I'm saying?
You're crazy, man.
Yeah, man. But that's what I remember, like trying to like be out and trying to holler at Caldwell. You know what I'm saying? Trying to put myself out there. You know what I'm saying? So you knew who I was. You know. But I think that was after my first year in the band. After we had crossed.
Man, those were good times, you know, not tainted by all the cell phones and all this social media. I would imagine that it's hard to remember anything like what you just talked about if you're one of these younger people right now on the campus. Man, it's these times, we lived in a golden time. Like, I really believe people who lived in the late 80s, grown-ups, you know, were living in a great time and didn't realize it. But as far as being in college, we were living in the actual last times of actually being students where, you know, being close meant you actually had to be physically close to a person.
Right.
You don't have to be close to a person now to be close to them. And that's extremely confusing if you were back in our times and someone were to tell you in 2020 that you could communicate with a person that lives across the country or out of the country every day for a minimal price And most of the time, you want to do physical activities, not with your friends. You want to do things virtually with them. And you would prefer to do virtual things with them rather than do physical things with them. And that's confusing, man. But topsy-turvy is now normal.
Yeah, that's real. Because I know I met a lot of people doing the show, and I still ain't met them in person yet. You know what I'm
and
saying?
And you feel real familiar with them, too, though.
Right. Yeah. But yeah, back then, I remember that was when, like email was just starting to come out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It was like, oh, man, you got an email. You can hit me up on my email. Or people were talking about the internet.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you're supposed to do all this dope stuff on the internet when the internet come out. You know what I'm saying? Again, shout out to the chat room. You got someone that said, what's up? Kamari, Tony's friend, said, what's up?
Kamari.
And then
I got a baby girl named Tony. My first child, she's 12 years old. She's adorable and I love her. I couldn't wait for a son, so I named her Tony. That's her
friend. Oh, nice, nice. Oh, okay. Round of applause.
Yeah.
That's dope. And then the Archie B, I'm not sure who that is, but they said they remember that jacket.
Archie Bennett. That's my cousin, man. Okay. Let's go, Archie. He's ice cold Archie Bennett.
Okay. That's what's up. All right. So that was the time I came in. So going back, what would you say was your most memorable experience there in 94?
In 94, my most memorable moments would all have to involve with that first band camp, not really getting to know the upperclassmen, but going through the experiences of figuring out who we were as crabs, being part of the crab class in 1994. You know, shout out to all the dog team, you know, Tuba Pups in 1994. You know, a lot of those guys, you know, they didn't even make it to the next year of school, but because of that one summer that we all spent together, everyone who made it through, man, I'm talking about, I still know all those guys' names and have contacts on most of them, but on a definite point, if they called me, I definitely would know who they were immediately. So that's the great thing about going to this HBCU, Jackson State University. Those experiences, I know you asked for one, but I would say band camp, first band camp itself is an experience. So that would be my most memorable as far as 1994 goes.
Okay. Cause I know a lot of y'all from 94 when they talk about it, just talk about how deep y'all were. You know what I'm saying? I know myself, band camp in 97. I mean, it was just scary. Like, I remember just being scared a lot. But one thing I remember about band camp in 97 was we just got crunk on. Like, you know, the merge now is like this thing. Like, when I be seeing it on social media, I be like, damn, the merge, like, people be talking about it and everything. It was just like a slaughter back in the day. Cause we would line up and play our stuff, and then y'all would just be playing for like 20, 30 minutes, just song after song. You know what I'm saying?
We were looking forward to it, man. I'm talking about we were looking forward to it. But like I said, the times that we live in now, people, they have this, you know, entitlement about them that is so confusing. I keep using that word confusing, but now people feel like because they're in the band, you know, they got accepted on paper that, you know, they're 110% band members and they should not do anything. And I don't mean hazing. I'm definitely against hazing. But I do feel like you shouldn't walk into anyone's home and feel like, even if they're treating you like a guest, feel like that you have just as much ownership in the home, you know, as the owners or the people who've been their guests for several times.
Right.
People wanted to come in and work for things. So, and of course, you didn't have all this television, and you know, drumline attitude. What was the little guy when he first came in? He made his mind up. He wanted to be the guy. And I love drumline because it drew attention to HBCU bands, to people who didn't have the privilege of knowing about it. I don't know where they were. Had to be under a rock to not already know about HBCU. But the drumline was the first time that you watched or came in contact with any experiences dealing with HBCUs. It was a good experience. The movie was well done. It was only people like myself and you, you know, people who actually lived during those times that they were trying to portray in the movie that had problems with certain aspects of it. But overall, it was a great light being shined on HBCUs when you see that movie.
Actually, I got another, somebody sent in a question. They said, hey, Dad. how was your first field show experience? The one and only Jasmine Walton. How was your first field show experience with the Boom?
It was wonderful. The first time marching into the stadium is like nothing that I can describe. I've had better experiences, you know, because I don't want to compare that to receiving religion or getting married or having kids, but at the same time, I want to tell you, it's like nothing that I could really describe. I enjoy marching into the band. I don't even think my entire first year I ever got over what it was like marching into the stadium. Like when you go from moving at one angle where you can't see anything but the side of a building, yeah, to making that flank, and then you start coming in and you can see the crowd and it's a whole animal looking at you, and you know, yeah. That would be your answer, Jazz.
Yeah, I know it was special because my dad marched at Jackson State, so
yeah.
Every time, you know, we went to Memphis every year, or if they was in Indianapolis, wherever we went, we followed. But I always just remember the pom poms, you know what I'm saying, the blue and white pom poms, and that was my biggest thing. Is like when I marched in the stadium for the first time. We played Howard, 97. Yeah, that was our first home game. And I remember never seeing the whole crowd. I was just like, damn, like, you know what I'm saying? It was something to stare at. You know what
I'm
saying?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, finally being in a band myself. But that was definitely special for me. All right, so, yeah, I got a couple questions popping in my head now. Okay, so you 94. You done marched, you had a good season and everything.
Hold up, before you ask this other question. Okay. We were winning. Jackson State was winning. You know, we might not have been winning championship after championship, but we were winning. You know, we were above 500 in football and basketball, and, you know, they're doing their thing in every sport. The city is different when Jackson State is winning. Believe what you want. People have not seen Jackson, no matter how good it's doing, you know, with the developments recently. I am very happy about Deion Sanders being the new football coach, because it is going to, well, it has done a lot of great things already. But, man, we haven't seen the fruit of what's going to come from Deion Sanders being – I just needed to stop you and go ahead and say that, Paul, because – these students are going to have experiences as students at Jackson State that the last 10 years or 15 years won't even be able to talk about.
I know.
Because it's different when we're winning, and our fans deserve winning. Let's go, Dion. Come on, Prime Time, Coach Prime. Let's roll.
I'm sure you remember. I think, like, after I got out or right after I finished Jackson State, that guy, I think his name was Bell.
Yeah,
light-skinned dude, Bell, mm-hmm. And he had, like, a horrible resume. Like, he was from the University of Indiana.
And let's not do that. I don't want to be a part of that. You know, I don't want to be a part of that because, you know, there was some football players that were pretty good on that team, and they might have felt like if the leadership wasn't the way it's supposed to be, you know, those are hurtful things to talk about. So I'm just going to talk about the other side of it. Now that we have this coach and we have these wonderful recruits who are taking their time to say, you know what, even though I know a lot of people want me at these other colleges and these other institutions, I do believe that I have the same ability to make it to the next level going here under Coach Prime. And once that first person makes it to the league, and we're probably going to see two or three make it the first, you know, at the end of next year. But once that first person makes it, then that's going to alleviate a whole lot of the doubt that the great athletes have across the country. You know, they have this misnomer and they have this thought that if I attend an HBCU, I cannot make it to the next level and I can't receive the tutelage that's going to make me a better player. I'll actually be doing them a favor if I go to the school because I'm so much better already. Well, that'll be over real soon. And there are a lot of people upset about that, but I'm not one of them. And I don't think that the other fans of JSU and, you know, great institutions like Jackson State University, you know, when other athletes wake up and see that they can help the same way that Coach Prime is going to help us, when they start winning like we will win this year, when they get those championship banners everywhere, like we're about to get those banners, you know, we're going to have some people to get up,
yeah,
raise up,
and
do what's
right. It's been a debate for years, too. You know what I'm saying? Even since we were small, about our own people going to our own schools. So I was happy for us, but I feel like it's a proud day for all HBCUs. You know what I'm
saying?
That's
right. That's right. But so, when you said for us, you know, you can rub people the wrong way. I was one of those persons that used to speak up on this often, and I was said politically incorrect. So now that's why I'm purposely saying it the way that I'm saying it now. With coaches like Coach Prime coming to places like JSU, it removes that barrier. I understand any athlete who thinks that the only way he can make it to the pros to increase his financial situation to help his family out a little bit more is to go to an Alabama or to go to an Oklahoma, you know, State or Oklahoma. You know, there was a time when people felt that way. There was a time when college athletes felt like if they were playing basketball, they had to go to a school like Duke or North Carolina. But as time has gone by, they find out you can go to any school that has exposure, that has an opportunity to play in certain games, and you can do those things. Well, it won't be long before, you know, if things pan out the way that I think that they will, it won't be long before all the best athletes will not feel like they have to go to those kind of schools. The best athletes will feel like they can go wherever they want to because it'll be a level playing field. And the best, you know, the cream will rise all the time. If right. you're the best athlete, you come to Jackson State, you should feel like the pros will still watch you perform throughout your collegiate career as well as watch you well enough to offer that money to you at the end.
Right.
It won't be long before we'll be in those bowl games. It won't be long before, you know, you'll see a lot of people on television wearing those JSU jerseys as they should. It makes me a proud alumni, and I can't tell you a lot about that.
Yeah, yeah, I'm excited too, especially because it's Deion. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I
yes,
was excited. Right. So I know I'm definitely excited. And then I saw his son. He used to have like a reality show back in the day. And I used to watch that. And his son was small, but now his son done grown up now. And he said that he going to Jackson State too to play quarterback. So
that's right.
So yeah. And I saw a couple of other transfers that they supposed to be getting too.
Hey, the hype is real, man, and reality is reality. Some coaches, in my opinion, they seem as if they are the best coaches, and I explain to people in my opinion they're the best coaches because they have the best athletes. You know,
right.
Once those best athletes get spread out amongst everyone else, it's only going to be a few people that are identified as the best. And I don't know if it'll be those Alabama coaches, you know. I don't know if it'll be the Phil Jacksons of the earth.
Right.
Those people going to fall right on into the middle of the crack like everyone else.
Right.
It'll be only the great coaches will stand out.
Right.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking forward to. We never know who's going to win the NFL championship, you know,
that's
the
real.
Super Bowl every year because, you know, the athletes are spread so far out. And at every given year, you can have any one given player that can play above or below, you know, what people kind of predicted he was going to do. Look at the Seahawks.
Seahawks.
Yeah, that's a small market team that was wrecking for a long period of time because of the overachievement of their players.
Right. Right.
Yeah. I'm one of those guys. I want to see Jackson State on the top.
Yeah, me too, man, because it's been a minute. You know what
it's
I'm saying?
It's been a minute.
It's been a minute. So I'm definitely welcome, you know what I'm saying, he can start winning. So, okay, so I asked you what was your most memorable time in 94. What would you say was your most memorable time marching all the years all together that you marched there for the boom?
I'll go two. The first one I'll say was watching Steve McNair in person. I got to see him one time in person play football, and it was phenomenal. He was so good, man, that it was hard to watch and not cheer for him. We had, because you had reasons to not cheer for him, but they didn't. He was getting attention to HBCUs on a different level. Right. So you didn't have any reason to want to see him fall. You wanted him to lose because, you know, you go to Jackson State, but at the same time, you don't want to see that football player not successful because he's on this level now. He came in third place for a Heisman Trophy from Alcorn.
Right.
Alcorn. You know, that's next level. You know, that's something that you wouldn't believe if you weren't a part of. So I'll put that one up there. And I think that the next one would be actually watching the clock run down after that Alcorn game at the end of the first year, you know, moving from being a crab to an upperclassman.
Right.
While I was watching that clock, I was contemplating, when are you going to tell the bros that you seriously, I did it that same night. Melvin Watson, who was my line brother.
Melvin.
Yeah, he's an administrator in Detroit. We did it the same night, man. We came back. We celebrated in the bleachers, you know, for what celebration was, because he was thinking the same thing on the other side of the field. When we got together, the first thing that we said is, when we doing? And, man, that's why that was so memorable, because I know that was the first night that I told the bros, which was a year before I went over. Mind you, I'm 1994, and I went over in 1997. Right. It was like one of the dumbest things that I could have done, but I did it, and he did it. You know, it worked out in the end. It's a story to tell, but.
Right.
That day was memorable for that reason. Everyone else was celebrating like it was over, and I'm like, man, it's just beginning.
Right. Right. I know a couple people that had that same experience. I was getting like hit. You know what I'm saying? I guess I'll just say that because I didn't get a chance to look at the clock countdown.
Yeah.
Somebody was doing something to me, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But of course, when it was over, you know, I was running around. But see, after that, for me, my experience, that's when I talked to you and introduced myself at Keon's house.
Because yes, sir.
Then that's when people were saying, it was like, okay, well, you got to go there and speak and, you know what I'm saying, let them know what you want to do. So that was then, I think that was, it was later 97 or like spring of 98. It was around that time when I first spoke to you and had like a 1.2 grade point average and didn't know that you had to have like a GPA to pledge anything. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah that was a trip. So that was my experience. Okay, so let me ask you now. You knew where you wanted to go to school and you marched and you had some outstanding experiences. Did you know what your major was going to be and what you wanted to do when you finished Jackson State?
You know, I came to school to be a teacher, and I wanted to be an English teacher. The administration and all those things, that were a byproduct of working in the public school system and finding out your limitations as a teacher and thinking you could do things as an administrator differently, and that's how I ended up getting into that. But I came to school to be an English teacher. I had a teacher by the name of Miss Rose Wiley. She taught senior seminar in Canton High, and she introduced me to a word, epiphany. Epiphany, which is a sudden realization, and a sudden realization or a sudden understanding. She gave 1,000 different examples to make you understand what it was, but every time I had an epiphany, I identified the new understanding of whatever was going on as an epiphany. And, you know, the best description I can give after all these years is an epiphany is when you realize the difference between actually believing there's a heaven and a hell and having control or doing something to make sure you don't go to hell, and when you didn't believe that there was a heaven or a hell. That's the ultimate epiphany. So, but my whole life, you know, ever since I heard her give that definition, every time I had a new understanding of something, it became an immediate identification of an epiphany to me. And so I knew I wanted to be an English teacher for that reason. No other reason. Not to help anyone with subject verb agreement or make sure that they could write a paper, you know, but because she touched me so much by introducing me to a word epiphany.
Wow. Okay. Wow. I didn't know that. That's a trip. Okay. So you knew you were going to be an English teacher then. Did you know, or were you thinking about leaving Mississippi for your opportunity, or did you know that you wanted to stay somewhere around where you were?
Well, what I knew was that I wanted to travel. And had I not gone over at YE, when I went over at Jackson State, my experiences probably would have been a little different. Because when I went over, we immediately started hitting the road and going everywhere. And so I would have eventually, by the age I am now, which is 44, I would be back in Mississippi probably doing the same thing, but I probably would have left and gone somewhere else for maybe 10, 15 years because of how my thought process was when I was young and in college. But when I went over, man, we traveled and went everywhere and you know, and did everything. And even when I'm working on my master's, which I started working on my master's before I started teaching. So I'm still being young and being really an undergrad student, but I was actually in grad school. So I was road tripping even more then and spending weeks, sometimes, you know, a month or two hanging out with bros or staying with somebody on this venture dealing with, you know, something political, or this venture with something that may help me, you know, with my profession or something, or just meeting somebody and having fun. So, yeah, I had no real aspirations to leave by the time I was eligible to be a teacher. I didn't want to leave the state. I actually was trying to sow roots up to see how fast it would be when I could retire. And I'm actually 5 years away from retiring, even though I don't, you know, legally I could retire in 5 years. Of course, I don't have any real plans to retire. I still feel young. I can probably outrun anybody who's watching this podcast right now.
So it's funny you say that because, again, you were one of the people that inspired me. I remember, like, my last couple years, and it was like my junior, senior years at Jackson State. I remember you said, I'm in grad school now, Joe. And I was like, damn, really? So you went straight through, and I remember I immediately made up that up in my mind. I was like, I don't know if I'm going to Jackson State for graduate school. I knew I wanted to see some more places myself, but I said, man, I'm going to do just like Caldwell. I know I'm going straight through, you know what I'm saying? Because I myself, I wasn't ready to start working. You know what I'm saying? I still had some, like, I felt like I had some kicking that still left to do. So, yeah, I knew that I was going straight to grad school.
Joe, I didn't have anything coming to college, you know, except for a few family members that could help me out with a dollar or two when they could help me out. You know, I had all the love that you want from, you know, our wonderful support as far as that goes with support as far as love. But, you know, like I said, my dad died when I was 3, and I couldn't ask a whole lot of people for a whole lot of stuff, so I went straight through school because it's easier to be broke when you're working toward not being broke.
Right.
You don't have to go get a house when you're still being out and being young. As long as you're in school, you can justify that. And so that was really my understanding. I didn't want to be stagnant. You know, because I've seen what the other side is like. And even though, again, I didn't know I was broke growing up, I don't want my kids to not know. I mean, you know, I don't want them to be broke.
Right.
You know, even though it's still check to check, you know, we live in the same economy that you live in. It's not we got paper or anything, but going to school, and I tell everybody young, anyone who's trying to make a change, the best thing to do is to receive a trade or a certification that the next man cannot get, because regardless of what they're paying,
right.
You know, and everybody can't go apply for the job. They may have all the intangibles that make them the best person, but if the job says you have to have this certification or, you know, this skill set in order for you to do it, when you don't have those things, you don't qualify. And so school gives you that leg up. You know, there's a program, a safe serve program dealing with the jobs for Mississippi graduates, and it's offered in some of the schools in JPS, and it simply gives you an opportunity to say, if there are 12 people coming in here identified that want to apply for a job at a restaurant, all of them going to have to go through a certain training before they're allowed to do certain things in the restaurant.
Oh, wow.
You show up in the group and say, I already have this certification. You're more likely to get the job than those other 11 people.
Right, right. That's actually really cool. You know, I think you may have posted something like that a while back, and I saw that. Because, you know, what's funny is, just piggybacking on what you're saying, when I got out of school, when I finished my master's degree, it still took me a while to find a job because everyone was saying that I didn't have no experience. I was like, well, goddamn. Like, I said, well, I got a master's degree. Like, and they was like, yeah, but we're looking for someone that's actually working. And it's kind of been, because I hadn't been to work at all.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So then that's when I started delivering pizzas. You know what I'm saying? And I had a paper route. So
yeah,
that's what I was doing until I got my first job. It took me a whole year to actually start working. So that's actually a really good point. Shout out to the chat room again. Hey, Ravitia Caldwell. Ravitia, I think that's her name. Ravitia Caldwell. She said Tiger Strong.
Tiger Strong, that's right.
And then the only AC, I don't know who that is, but they said, hey, Dad. You give a round of applause and say, hey, Dad.
Hey, Dad. AC Anderson, my son is Anderson Caldwell, and that lovely name you were trying to pronounce, that's my beautiful wife, Ravisha Caldwell.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you know, they're special. They on Team Caldwell all the time.
Yeah, that's what's up, man. I remember her, too, and I think it was when you guys were first dating, but it had to be like 99, 2000, something like that.
That would be it. 99.
Yeah. That's when I saw her. You introduced me to her. I remember that. So that's what's up. That's all good, right? Y'all still kicking it and starting together.
She's working at Jackson State, man. She's a professor up there, challenging minds and changing lives every day.
Okay. All right. That's what's up. And they said, now there you go. They said Team Caldwell for life. You're a round of applause. That's what's up. All right. So, when did you then finish at Jackson State, and then you rolled right into grad school, right? What year was that?
All those years rolled together, man. I actually I went right behind. When I graduated, I went straight into my master's, and when I finished my master's, I started a few classes at USM on the specialist, but ended up coming back to Jackson and finishing my specialties in ed administration at Jackson. And I've been working since then, man. You know, I've been, I don't even want to go into all the stuff that I've been doing. But I do want to say this, that going to Jackson State, and this is not, I struggle with how I'm going to put this, because all three of my degrees coming from Jackson State has not put any kind of limitation on me. And I was actually working on a doctorate program for a minute because I actually felt like I just needed that different degree. But I'm not at that point anymore. I don't want to go to school for anyone. I think I found the career that I want to work until I get to my retirement. I feel real fulfilled there. But I need to say again, those Jackson State degrees have allowed me an opportunity to travel this country, these United States, inside the United States, so many times over on the dime with someone else. And I've received so many different certifications from unique universities, even in Ivy League school, where I compare myself personally and according to their ratings, you know, it was still a competition, but I've always found that I was on par with everyone else, no matter which university they went to, or I was at least close enough to say that I'm very proud to be a graduate of Jackson State. So I know that was a little side note, sidebar. I just wanted to throw that part out there because I'm proud of my school, man.
I gotta give a round of applause for that. You know, in my experience, since we've been out of school, I either meet people that say, you know, if I could do it again, I would have gone to Jackson State, or I would have gone to Morehouse. Like, they say that they want to go to a black school after what they know now. You know what I'm saying? And then the other people that I know, they'll say, wow, you know what I'm saying? I'm just as smart, or I'm just as prepared for this job as, you know what I'm saying, these people that went to Alabama or these people that went to Tennessee. Like, you don't see any difference where they come out because they went to a PWI, they so much more prepared and they well, so much
I,
more sparring.
I think, Joe, you know that wherever they go, they, you know, you get an upper leg for going to a university. You go to a university and you receive specialized training in any one thing and you actually are serious at it, you got heads up on the next guy. Even if he has a degree or a certification in the same thing, if he hasn't been serious about it, no matter which university you went to. I do think had I grown up with different financial support, you know, different upbringing, I would have prioritized going to a PWI at least to receive one of my degrees. I actually, like I told you, I had prioritized it. Circumstances didn't allow me to finish, and convenience of being in Jackson and working in JPS at the time made it easy for me to go, you know, to Jackson State at the time instead of going to a MIRSAL, which would still been convenient, but it was a little bit more expensive, and it didn't allow me during the time that I had free to work. But I went to this program right here, and it's called the Collegiate Black Male Retreat, and it was in 2017 on the University of Texas campus. And there were it was primarily students from all the colleges in Texas, but out of Mississippi, I want to say Valley was represented there, Jackson State was represented there, and that was it. And it might have been five other states in the whole United States of America that they accepted students. But the other students didn't come from HBCUs. They were African-American students who went to schools that were predominantly white. They just were smaller white schools.
Okay.
But what I found out and what was the most touching about the program is that the people who were coming there had not even been exposed to African-American culture. These were black guys who were coming. They were about to finish school, or they were actually just making it to the precipice of being a real college student, meaning going through their second semester of their sophomore year, trying to find out who they are. And then they come there, and they never been around a room full of black guys in their lives.
Yeah, that's crazy.
But that's why you have to be prepared all the time. You got to have your spirituality has to be in place. Who you are has to be in place, because you never know how hard a person is looking into what you're seeing. You're actually trying to explain to them. You're giving them an answer to the question that they ask, but the question that they ask may be the answer to a whole side of who they are. Mm-hmm. And you don't realize how much you're impressing them with your response.
Right.
You got to be prepared. You say you're a college graduate. People are looking who've never gone to college. They're looking for there to be something different in you than the person who did not go to college. They want to say, damn, you can tell that this man is a college degree person just because of the way he carries himself, just because of this. So even though I'm still the same Caldwell that you remember, and, you know, like I tell my wife all the time on the inside, I'm still the same Caldwell that she met. It takes special times for you to see that Caldwell. You know, it really just has to come out most of the time when you're referring to memories about the past.
Right, right. Yeah.
So I gotta ask you then, and then I do want to ask you something about the boom real quick.
Love the boom.
So let's say you did have an opportunity to go to a PWI. Where you think you would have went?
Oh man, I almost went to Marquette in Wisconsin.
Oh, Wisconsin. Oh snap. Okay.
Yeah, honestly, I almost went there. I'm talking about before I came to Jackson State. It was by chance. Like I said, I grew up in Camp, Mississippi, and my father and his brother, they built a home that we grew up in. It's a home that's off the ground. And one period of time, there was this group of people that came. They were traveling people that came and, you know, did free stuff for you. I don't know what they were called, and I was a little boy. Like a ninth grader, tenth grader. And they came there, and they were doing some work on my grandmother's house beside ours on the roof of it. And I went over there, you know, my mom made, she fried some chicken and she made me take it over there and offer it to them, because all these people were Caucasian people. Again, I told you I grew up in country, right, in the country part of Canada, on the Rock Road. Man, I was talking to these people and, you know, I guess they thought they were dealing with someone ignorant, probably because of their misconceptions or, you know, preconceived notions about African Americans. They just assumed that I was dumb because, you know, I didn't show up dressed the best, and I looked like it was summertime in Mississippi. I rode a bus to Cass, so you're walking around, you know, with sandals on, no shoes, whatever it is.
Right.
Anyway, I brought the food over there to them, and they were sitting under the tree talking to me, and then they started saying stuff like, my, you're intelligent, and you know, little stuff like, we see a monkey that's turning flips and dancing, And so as time went by, they started offering money and scholarships to me. They started calling people, man, back at Marquette on the telephone. It was sending, they were sending legitimate letters to my home, offering this, that, and the other, showing me criteria for full scholarships because of these minority quotas they got to meet. And everything that they had on the paper, you know, I met it. I just didn't want to go that far. You know, again, it's hard to go somewhere where you don't have the kind of support. If my baby girl or my sons say they want to go to Marquette, they really wouldn't have any thoughts about not going except missing us or, you know, being afraid to be away from home. They wouldn't be worried about the support coming to them. They wouldn't be worried about how much they'll have to depend on that financial aid and that kind of stuff. But all that kind of stuff is in the back mind of most African-Americans, like it was in my head. And that's why it takes special kinds of people, you know, which are us. You know, everyone who's gone through these experiences, you have to be prepared at any given moment, at any time, to tell people younger than you where you were before you got where you are right now. Because other than that, they won't listen to you. They'll think that you've been one of those persons who's gone to the PWI because everyone had money for you to go there, not because you were one of the lucky ones to get the scholarship and, you know, it was close enough to your home where you could still get the support, whatever the case may be. They're not going to see that because in their head, them admitting that you had to struggle to get to where you are says that they should do the same thing and that they can do it. A lot of times people put those things and their own barriers on them, and it takes people who look like them and can say that they had the same experience that they're going through right now to make them realize, I'm not lying to you. I'm not just telling you that you can fly. You see me flying. This is where I grew up at right here. You tell me about your problems, I can show you two of mine. But, you know, all of them could be overcome, particularly if you got, you know, if you understand Christ, if you understand God and you pray. That's a different story, you know, because I don't want to get into that.
Yeah. That's actually a really good point, is just sharing the experiences. Because, I mean, that definitely shaped a lot of what I know and even how I even started a podcast, especially during the National Signing Day, just making sure I tell kids to go to class.
That's right.
That was my thing because, I mean, I wasn't really tripping about a degree. I mean, I knew that was what I was supposed to do, but I was tripping about marching in the band. Like, that was all I was tripping off of. And then, like, after that first semester, when I saw what my grades were, I spent the rest of my years petitioning classes, you know.
Yeah.
And it was cool that I was motivated, that I wanted to pledge, because that at least gave me something to shoot for. It was like, okay, I'm trying to be like Caldwell, like, you know what I'm saying? I'm trying to be out, blah, blah, blah. So at least it helped me focus and get some stuff done.
But not just even the boom or the band or the brood. Just think about all the people that you marched in the band with who didn't think about going Greek that were progressing in school, and you can see that they're getting ready to move on to the next level.
Right.
Or how many people you graduated high school with that went in different directions, and now they're on the precipice of moving into being a professional. You don't want to get left behind.
There
you find
go.
Yourself like, you know, I need to hustle or do something different. I don't mind going a little harder because I played around at the beginning. Let me catch up.
Right. And that's my main thing, and that's how I started to let people know. It's like, you know, establish yourself economically or academically. You know what I'm saying? Don't be messing around, not going to class. You know what I'm saying? I know I love the band, you love the band, but you got to remember why you there. And that was the biggest thing. That was my lesson when I look back on stuff. I try to let people know and share my experiences, like you just said. I do want to ask you real quick about 97, because it was a couple of experiences I had, but I wanted to ask you about.
Okay.
So the one that I mainly, which was always, and I didn't put this out there, as my most memorable experience of my crab year in 97 is when we played Southern. And Southern got there early and waited for us to get in front of them to start playing Hay in the middle of the barn.
Mm-hmm.
What was your memory of that experience? If I could take you back to that day, what was going on in your head that day?
What was going on in my head that day was how a lot of the time Dr. Liddell used to say things that didn't have any validity to you because you're young and you're ignorant at the time. You're not thinking about what he's saying. He
right.
was terrible at how he was trying to relay his messages off me too. So, but all I can think is, you know, without, I don't even want to say what he would have said, but he was, a lot of the times people don't have tact and they are just ignorant. They don't know any better. When you are a band director of a prestigious school like Southern University, who has no more, no less fans or people who have aspirations, particularly musical aspirations to march in the band or become a band director of a band like that band, and you do something tactless like instruct your band directors to start a fanfare about weed out loud while a band is trying to go in on their cadence to get into a small little space that you gave them to turn around and maneuver and play back at you. You wouldn't even let us march, get directly across from you and blow back at you. So I just felt bad for them. It wasn't a good look for HBCUs, but the difference was everything wasn't televised like it is now. If you were to do something like that now, it would receive scrutiny, you know, nationwide scrutiny from people like myself and people like you, you know, particularly people like you with these podcasts and all these folks who do all this social media stuff, you know. People would be mad. That band director would want to quit.
Yeah, let me give Ryan some booms. You know what I'm saying? Get folks some booms. I just remember it made us mad.
Yeah.
So, boy, we was ready. I mean, when we got in the stands, boy, we was ready to kill them. But then, you remember they left.
They left.
I was like, oh, what y'all leave early for? You know what I'm saying? Y'all going to do that? And I remember they started putting their hats on, like, right at the end of the fourth quarter. And they sure dipped up out of there. So,
but you know, the year prior to that, I know you weren't in the band. That whole hype was that they had this extensive book and they never stopped playing and they never let the other band run them out. Well, we practiced on purpose to make sure our book was more extensive than theirs, and we blew so long on them with so many different songs that they turned their book over. And for all you listeners that don't know what turn the book over is, that means that you push repeat on a song. That means that you end up playing one of your songs for a second time. And at that point, it's an embarrassment if you already told everyone that you have so many songs you don't ever need to turn your book over. We were proud of it. Yeah. So the next year, they didn't want to compete. We took too long and they turned the lights off on us the year before. So to keep it lasted probably longer than the game. This is no lie, Joe. We were there for more than 2 hours blowing back and forth.
In 96.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they left right out. They dipped really fast in 97. And they dipped, even when we went to Southern in 98, they left real fast too. Like, I don't know what was going on them years or why they didn't want to stick around.
We got those new horns in 97 too, Joe. I'm telling you, it's a lot of stuff. In 94 and 95, it might have been 96 we got those new horns. But in 94 and 95, we had really shabby horns. That was one of the experiences that we had as crabs. You know, every day we had to get to practice early enough to tie holes up in the horn and find new holes before we played.
I remember that.
Yeah, because if you weren't producing any music, if the sound wasn't coming out of the horn, regardless if it was the horn or you, you're going to get talked about. We had, what, four upperclassmen, Tellis, Cordell, Nikki, and Johnny. I don't think it was anybody else over there. They grabbed that dude, Tatum brother, from the trombone section and put him back there, but I think that was it. Bruh, they let you know when it wasn't in the sound coming out of the horn. So when we got those new horns, man, we were ready for Southern. When we had real horns, we were ready to blow.
Yeah, I remember the duct tape. Yeah. I remember y'all putting duct tape on the horns, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was a crazy time. And then, of course, like, right before, I guess, like, after our era, so to speak, that's when they got the new uniforms.
Yeah.
That was the thing. We wanted some new uniforms, too. I remember that.
Man, it's so beautiful. If you look at these videos that's online right now, you know, even though the cinematography, the way they have with these good cameras, you can make any band really look like it's decent. The same way people steal the bros, real steps that you have to learn from, you know, blood, sweat, and tears, and they go and learn them like they band video. I mean, you know, like a dance move. But, bro, watching the Sonic Boom on video now, man, it makes you proud. And it just makes you wonder, particularly while we were doing it so raw then, how you would look on those videos. Not you particularly, but I'm saying you, meaning your year.
Right.
Or your drum majors, you know what I'm saying? You just think about some of the stuff or DJ sets during this time. So I'm really proud, man. I'm proud that when Coach Prime became the coach, JSU's marketability went up $19 million. And, you know, that doesn't mean that we are worth more, $19 million more. That means that more people want to put our stuff in their stores now, you know.
Right.
Dick's Sporting Goods nationwide is carrying our stuff. Before you know it, you know, you will see JSU paraphernalia and all the Foot Lockers across the country. You know, little stuff like that you don't really pay that big attention to. But when it happens, all of a sudden, your campus change. All of a sudden, your facilities for your students and your student athletes change. You know, the commercials that you can play on television and how far those commercials can reach. Like right now, how many commercials you think coming on television in Salt Lake City? You know, they got a Salt Lake City, Real Housewives of Salt Lake City.
I and saw I'm like, that.
Come on now, what are you reaching really, really far when you say you're going to Salt Lake City to find some housewives? But that's neither here nor there. You know, that's a pet peeve of my wife. She hates when you say that. Neither here nor there, but it's crazy.
Yeah, it is.
Jack and Fate will have paraphernalia in a Foot Locker in Salt Lake City. That's next level, man.
It is. I even seen when they did the promo, I believe, and they had all those people on there, and Troy Aikman was like, talking about
That's
Troy.
Right.
I was like, what was it?
That's
Troy,
right.
What you know about Jack State, boy?
That's right, man.
So yeah, that made me proud. But yeah, another thing to piggyback on what you said, I know I'm proud too, just to see that the band hadn't lost a step and we still going on. Like now, just to, you know, still big sit back and be like, well, yeah, I went to Jackson State, like, and to see we still running things and we still up there around the top, it does make you proud. Because you know, I mean, as much as people love fam, you know, they fell off for a little while and we all know why. But still, you went to Florida A&M, man. They ain't really the same just yet. You know what I'm saying?
It's different, man, when you come from a city that has marketability or a state that has marketability on next level. Jackson doesn't have any other real marketability. And we are the premier part of the city. So it is great when a place like Jackson State makes it to the next level because it's so good for everything around here. The hotels fill up, you know, people that are visiting here are going to shop at the local places where they can spend their money, restaurants. All those things really matter. And those are the kind of things that a capital city want and need. So when Jackson State becomes a bigger part, because it's already a big part, when it becomes a bigger part of Jackson's economy, you know, the input from Jackson State alumni will matter. You know, I honestly am one of the people that feel like the zoo should be moved to the other side of town because it makes Jackson better. Mm-hmm. It makes Jackson more marketable. But, you know, I'm not in a position where my voice matters right now, but eventually I will. And that'll be one of the things that I want to talk about. But I love JSU and I love the direction that the city's going in. Jackson State's leadership, even though, you know, in the process of still identifying who the new president would be, you know, we have Dr. Deborah Mays Jackson there, wonderful person, straight Jackson. We have the athletic director, man, the moves, the recent moves that he's made shows that, you know, leadership is there. I'm even happy about the leadership of the district that I work in Jackson, you know, on JPS. I work under a wonderful female. Man, I've worked under so many great leaders that are ladies that, you know, I don't know. I'm a blessed guy, and I'm really happy to be where I am right now in life. And the boom, man, again, who I am right now, the boom had just as much as, you know, teachers in high school had to do with who I am right now today.
Right, right. So that's a good spot. I want to stop there and let's do the second round of commercials. And then we'll hear from our other sponsors. And then we'll come back. And then starting, that'll be like the springboard to the next part of the interview where I'm asking, like, you know, how if there was anything specific that the band did for you today and what you're doing today. And then what you're doing today, what your career has been like since you got out of school. So you can go ahead and mute your microphones. Thanks again. And give a round of applause for all the folks that's listening, especially in the chat room. You chopping it up with the one and only Tony Caldwell. We'll be right back after these round of the commercials from our beloved sponsors.
You want the best barbecue around? Smokey O's coming to your town. Ribs, chopped beef, baked potatoes too. Smokey O's know what's good for you. You want the best barbecue around? Smokey O's coming to your town. Ribs, chopped beef, baked potatoes too. Smokey O's know what's good for you. Smokey O's, come check us out.
All right, this next commercial is a live read from the one and only Michael Okoro from MathSciTutor.com, providing online and one-on-one instruction for high school and college students in algebra, geometry, trigonometry, calculus, physics, and chemistry. Visit MathSciTutor.com. That's MathSci-Tutor, TUTOR.com. Or schedule a session and contact Michael Okoro at michael@mathsci-tutor.com. Especially now with the distance learning and everyone being at home, this would be a great opportunity for you guys to reach out and get help for your young student in math. So that's the one and only Michael Okoro with algebra, geometry, trigonometry, calculus, physics, and chemistry. Visit MathSci-Tutor.com. This next read is for the one and only Sofia's Barbecue and Fish, the outstanding St. Louis-style barbecue out here in Southern California. You guys reach out to Sofia's Barbecue and Fish either on Facebook, or they also have opportunities with DoorDash and Grubhub. You guys reach out. They are located at March Air Force Base out here in Riverside, California. And the one and only owners are there from the greatest country, or the greatest city out there, St. Louis, Missouri. Giving that special flavor and special twang, if you will, to their barbecue and fish. And they also have the good greens and sweet potato pies. Whole bunch of things that you would love here out there in Southern California. So you guys reach out to Sofia's Barbecue and Fish out here in Southern California, your St. Louis style barbecue. All right, and this last live read is for the one and only Bull City Music School. Bull City Music School, the modern approach to music. Enroll today and experience one of our virtual classes, and I can personally say they're great. My daughter is a student at Bull City Music School learning the piano, and her teacher, Janetta Powell Hopkins, is doing an outstanding job. So shout out to Janetta. I went to school with her. She went to school with Caldwell. So we all remember Janetta from school, and she's out there in North Carolina creating things from scratch, and we're really proud of her. You guys contact Bull City Music School at 919-423-5701. That's 919-423-5701. Or go to their website, bullcitymusicschool.com. That's bullcitymusicschool, all one word, .com. Bull City Music School, the modern approach to music.
Do you like marching bands? Do you love band videos? Go subscribe to Lamik's Videos YouTube channel. Lamik's Videos YouTube channel has the largest archive of unbiased marching band videos on the internet. iPad giveaways, AirPod giveaways, and more. Go subscribe to Lamik's Videos YouTube channel right now.
Hello, this is Keenan Bush, entrepreneur, coach, and trainer, currently the founder of Keen Vision, Design, and Branding, and you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hey, this is Kenny, and you're listening to the Marching Podcast. Hello, this is Sloan Toussaint Baptiste, personal trainer and CEO of Chessboard Enterprise. I'm also a graduate of Rutgers University, and I now live in California, where I teach young people how to play chess and start up business enterprises. And you're listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hello, this is Dr. Martin Rex Kedziora. I am the Chief Academic Officer for the Moreno Valley Unified School District. I'm a graduate of the University of Laverne, where I received my doctorate degree, and you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hello, this is Jamie Barnett, California educator, graduate of Cal State University at Long Beach, Chi Beta Chapter, Spring 98, Q Psi Phi, and you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
And this your boy Brandon
and Javante,
and we the Rogers Bros, and you rocking with my man Joe Big
for the Marching Podcast.
Yeah.
All right, you can unmute your microphones, and remember that if you would like to be a sponsor to the show, just contact us, and it's all for free now. Let me give a round of applause. It's all free. Just hit me up and just get a hold of me, and we'll be able to get some things going with the Marching Podcast to promote your business and all that you do. So definitely hit us up, and we'll be honored to put your commercial, or you see down there at the bottom of the ticker, our beloved sponsors down there below. We would love to have you on here. So definitely contact us so we can help build your business. All right, so we have the second part of the interview with Caldwell. I do want to ask you, because we get into your professional career now, what would you say you learned from the band that prepared you for your career today?
I learned the real correlation between effort and hard work and success. You know, the harder you work at something, the more likely it is that you're going to be successful at it. And you can see degrees, several different degrees of success, because if you're good, if everybody in the line is good, the upperclassmen made sure they put a line of, you know, separation. Even if you are a little bit better than this guy, they wanted you to know about it so that they, you know, healthy competition is good. And, you know, anytime that you can get some constructive criticism and learn from it, you know, it makes you a better person. So that's what I would say. You, when you a crab, you have to learn to hear a lot of bad stuff. And your character is what determines whether you can use some of that stuff to benefit you, or if you use it and just, you know, make yourself salty at the person talking to you and say that you're a victim the whole time that they're talking to you, instead of using their criticism to get better.
Right, right. So then that leads us a segue, if you will, then to what you are doing today. What was the first thing that you did when you finished your master's at Jackson State?
I started teaching middle school English, and I started coaching middle school basketball.
Okay, there in Jackson?
Correct.
Okay, all right.
Chestnut Middle School. Chestnut Warriors.
You did that. How long did you were you there in the middle school?
I probably tied 4.5 years before I got into administration.
Okay, all right. Now, did you know you wanted to be an administrator, like after, because you had some years
of teaching?
No, sir. Okay.
As a teacher, I went through two different administrators, and when I got to the second administrator, I think things changed a little bit in the school, with the climate of the school, and I realized that administrators had a whole lot of impact on the performance of students in the school. And if you can reach the performance of students in the school from your office, good or bad, that's a powerful position. And I feel like I need to get into administration so I can help students more, okay. If that makes sense.
Yeah, that's funny, because I didn't actually know that. Like, I thought it was more, I guess, the teachers. And I mean, to a certain degree, it is them.
It is. Research says that it's the teacher. And, you know, directly it is, because if you have a good teacher, even if you have a terrible climate, if the student's head is into academics, they'll move forward. But the problem is, that's usually on a high school level. When you're talking about elementary and middle school, the intrinsic motivation to do well in school is not usually coming from the students. It's usually to satisfy a requirement to move to the next grade or to make somebody that they love happy, like their parents. So that was the case in middle school with us. The students didn't really make their mind up that they wanted to give everything that the teacher wanted them to give. Therefore, the whole climate of the school has to be one conducive that celebrates any gains academically, any behavioral changes that are positive. You know, you need all those things to be in place in middle schools particularly.
Okay. Yeah. So then after you came to this realization, then you then reached out to be an administrator after that. Where did you go after you left middle school?
When I left middle school, I became assistant principal at Forest Hill High School. And I had great experiences there. I worked under Dr. Deborah Mays Jackson. This was her first principalship, and she is a goal-oriented leader, you know, to say the least. She had a mind made up that she wanted to leave a legacy at Forest Hill. She wanted to leave a great legacy there, and I was along for the ride initially. And by the end of that first year, I felt like I was just an integral part of moving that school forward as she was, and that's how she wanted me to feel. That's how she wanted her whole team to feel, and it was a great experience. That school, again, some great leaders I've had that have been ladies in the district, but Forest Hill kind of forged me. That's my first time really going all the way into the fire and finding out that you're in the fire and your leader. You always say you want your leader to give you the leeway to hang yourself, you know, give me what I need to be successful and move out of the way. And yeah, she was one of those persons, but when she moved out of the way, you know, you make a little mistake, she lets you know about it. So Forest Hill was a great experience.
All right, let me give you a round of applause real quick. You mentioned the great Forest Hill. Shout out to my crowd brother, Ron Duplessis.
All right.
That's where he came from.
That's right. That's right.
And I forgot Sweet
Chick. He was a rebel now. He was a Forest Hill rebel. Boy, the administrative team that I was a part of, we changed their name from the Forest Hill Rebel to the Forest Hill Patriots. And that's a whole lot better ring to it if you're an African-American student going to a school that used to have a stigma to it. You much rather say that I'm a Forest Hill Patriot as opposed to saying I'm a Forest Hill Rebel. And I'm proud, very proud to be a part of that team. That was a great thing. That was a historic move, and I'm happy to be a part and have my name associated with it.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that at all. I just remember Ryan went there, and our other crowd brother, Sweet Chuck. I don't even remember Sweet Chuck's real name. I know he played trombone.
Sweet Chuck's real name was William Beard. And look, William Beard's mother was another strong leader that I had. Her name is Amy Beard, and I worked under her as the coordinator for the Young Males of Color, and I was one of the leaders of the Call Me Mister program. Man, when I say another time in my life when I just had some great experiences, and during this time I was representing Jackson State University all over the country as an ambassador for the great university, and I'm proud of that time in my life.
Wow. No, I didn't even know that. I remember Will. Okay, I remember Will. We sometimes called him Will. I remember that. But, man, we called him Sweet Chuck. As you know, you call somebody by their crab name so much.
That's right.
I don't remember. Was 12? Was he 94 or 95? 12.
I think 12 was 96.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I don't even remember his name. Like, I'd be seeing him on Facebook. I'd be like, oh, that's – and then I see their name. And I'm like, damn, that's his name? You know what I'm saying?
I don't know Twell's real name either, really. Him and Skeet. I know Skeet last name, Alvarez, but I don't know the real names Skeet, either. They probably don't know anything but Caldwell for me.
Right. Yeah, you say Skeet, too. I do remember, I think he from Oklahoma or something like that.
Yeah, both of them from Oklahoma.
Yeah, that's all I remember. But, yeah, it's funny when you talk about somebody's real name. So that's funny. Okay, so let me jump back real quick because you answered my next question as far as memorable experiences there at Forest Hill. Did you have a memorable experience at Chastain Middle School?
Yeah, I have very memorable experiences at Chestnut Middle School. At Chestnut Middle School, I had to go to a trial for the Keon Pittman, Carla Hughes murder. That little situation right there. People had me on television nationwide. Wow. So yeah, that was a very, very traumatizing experience. But yes, it was memorable nonetheless.
Right, right. Okay, okay. So how long were you there at Forest Hill?
4 years.
Okay, okay. And then after you left Forest Hill, where did you go from there?
Principal Hardy Middle School. That's a middle school in Jackson where Proud Panthers prepare for progress.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Now, was this your first time? This was your first time being the actual principal?
Correct.
What then would you say was, I guess, the biggest transition for you? Because you done seem like you done been at all the levels. You've been a teacher, you've been assistant principal, and then you are principal. What would you say was the transition between the two? What's something that jumps out at you as far as going from a teacher all the way up to a principal?
The accountability level goes up, but at the same time, your influence goes up. So I was happy about the both of them. You know, I would rather know things to keep myself out of high water. So when the accountability is on me and I know exactly what I'm being accountable for, I can talk to the powers that be about making sure that I have the resources that I need, or start off by telling you what I can accomplish without certain resources. Once you get a chance to look at the whole thing, and I wasn't able to do that as the assistant principal. You just wait for direction. Even though I had a great leader and she took care of all that, had she not been a great leader and she didn't take care of it, you know, it wouldn't have been an ideal situation for me.
Okay. Okay. And then what would you say was then your most memorable experience being a principal there at Hardy Middle School?
At Hardy Middle School, my most memorable experience is... the first time that I realized the climate of the school had completely changed. I'm a relationship person. So the people that, when I first started the school, that didn't like me, a lot of them became an advocate just like me because, you know, I was focused from day one on students. And even though the teachers are focused on the students too, if you come in directly with a laser light focused on students, sometimes it seems like you might be anti-teacher. And it may take a year or a couple of months, even up to a year, maybe two. It didn't take 2 years though, but it could have taken up to that time for people to buy into what you're trying to accomplish. So every time more and more people were on board with what we were supposed to be doing from the jump anyway, even if I'm one of the persons who ended up waving and they have to put me back on, you know, on point. Once we got to that point where our system was kind of holding each other accountable, that will probably be my most memorable moment. That will probably be my third year there.
Okay, okay. It's interesting that you say that, because, I mean, that starts to, like, kind of paint the picture for me, because I'm already, you know, being a teacher, okay, you got your lesson plans, but then I guess you actually got to have some type of vision being an admin. So let me ask you then. So let's say you wanted to say, all students need to get here by a certain time, or all students, like, we have a dress code or something like that. If you think of something like that in your mind, is it hard, like, pushing it through so that it becomes part of the school? Or, like, is it easy because, like, you the principal, and I pretty much, like, if you can say something or decide something, it goes right through. Was it hard, like, implementing, like, a change or something that you felt like that was going to make the school better?
If it was a change and it was a district-wide change, that means it's a mandate. If it's a mandate, everyone has to change regardless, and at that point, part of your job is enforcing it or getting buy-in for it, which basically is the same thing. And that one is easy for me because it's either, you know, you do it this way because it's our job to do it this way, or it's a problem. Now, what I can do to alleviate that stress is help you understand how to do it or get you to the professional development to do it. Now, I think what you were referring to is that there's a unique change, you know, just unique to your own school. You don't really want to make any changes unless stuff is done all the way wrong, unless you get buy-in from everybody who you expect to abide by. So if it's a change that's going to affect the students directly, at minimum, they need to know why the change was made and how it's going to be enforced. First, how it's going to benefit them and why it needs to be enforced the way that it's going to be enforced. But if you're asking the teachers to enforce it, they got to completely understand and buy in before you can even take it to the students. So there's different levels to getting things accomplished. And, you know, once you do it a few times, you just put it all into the same category. Because technically, they all fall into the same category. Either it's a mandate or it's something that you're doing for improvement. You don't just make changes, just make changes unless you a bored person and you're trying to put some fluff up. I don't do all that.
Right. Okay, okay. So that's interesting. So how long were you there at Hardin then?
At Hardy Middle School. I was there for 4.5 years.
Okay, okay. And then after that, where did you go from there?
I left and went to Jackson State as a program coordinator. And a year after that, I was, a year and a half after that, you know, that was a granted position. And that's when I was coordinator for the young males of color. And I served as advisor to the Call Me Mr. program. Once that money ran out, I became a professor at Jackson State. And worked in a summer program called STARS, which is Students Trained for Academic Readiness and Success. And that was about 5 years of my life working at Jackson State holistically. It may have been a little bit longer when you put both of them together. But another experience that I wouldn't trade for anything, COVID and a whole lot of other things ended up changing. And, of course, the position where I am right now became available. And at this stage of my life, I just wanted to try this, and I love it. I love the staff that I work with. I actually love the supervisor that I work under. She's another lady, like I said. I keep running into all these wonderful female leaders. I'm just blessed. My kids, my wife are happy and healthy, you know. Bills paid. I can still run and dunk a ball on a good day.
Nice.
Not a lot of complaints.
All right, so let me ask you then, too, what would you say was a memorable, because you named a couple of programs, and I did want the listeners to know about those programs. What was the first program that you said, the Call Me Mr. program?
Well, the Call Me Mr. program was one component of it. I was a coordinator for the Young Males of Color.
Young Males of Color, that's what it is. Could you tell us about that?
All right, there were several programs sponsored by COSBOC, Coalition of Schools Educate Morals of Colors. Did a lot of traveling and listened to a lot of people talk to you about best practices with dealing with African American males, and went with throughout the middle schools and JPS and tried to put some of those things into action. Dr. Kefale, I met him in Boston, Massachusetts, and one of the things that he put on my heart and that I put in place in JPS, what was it called? College Bound Scholars, was the recipe for success. And the recipe for success is, who are you? You know, making sure that young people understand that knowing who they are goes beyond just knowing their first and last name and who their mom and dad is, actually, and tells those things as well as, you know, what your morals, your values are, what you value, what you fear, you know, whoever you are, all those things are tied into it. So it's who are you, what are your long and short-term goals, and if students don't have long-term goals, you have them establish one of those, and then you teach them to use the short-term goals to accomplish the long-term goal, and you teach them what to do if they're not making progress. And we got a lot of buy-in because that's a really, really simple concept. And when you put simple concepts that have lasting effects in place in front of young people, they tend to hold on to those when you don't make it too complex.
Right.
As they get older, they realize the complexity of it, you know, as their intelligence level increases.
Yeah, that's actually a good point, just making it simple, because I know it'll deter a lot of people if it's too complicated.
Scare them away.
Yeah. So that's pretty dope that that was one of the components, if you will. And then the other program Stars, I believe you said it was. What was that? What was that? And then what did you do in that program?
Stars is a summer enrichment program. It gives students an opportunity. First, Stars is not a program just for Jackson State. It's really a program to help any student who fails to meet the requirements to come to a four-year college. It helps them get that requirement. So we have students that will come through our STARS program, and they plan to go to Mississippi State, or they may be planning on going to Alcorn. But oftentimes when the students finish the program, they do come to Jackson State. But that's all it is. The program is an eight-week program that gives you an opportunity to receive the equivalent of your ACT mastery or your SAT mastery.
Wow. And then ACT mastery, is that actually taken?
Yeah, you don't have to take the test again. You'll pass in the program. Finishing the STARS program will be the equivalent. It will get you in school as a full-fledged freshman.
Wow.
And several students take advantage of it. And we're proud. We boast that we have it right here in the city of Jackson. You know, so it's accessible to a lot of people for a lot of institutions that they may want to go to.
Right. That's dope. Okay, so do you have anything, any individual experiences that stuck out between those two programs or when you were working there at Jackson State?
Let me tell you, man, the biggest thing that I think impressed a lot of young people at Jackson State is that I worked there with my wife, and that we were really happy with each other, and that we both talk about God, and that we were helpful because, you know, again, hearing a sermon and seeing a sermon, two different things. It's different when you hear that you can go to college and you can fall in love with your sweetheart and you can, you know, high stay faithful in a room full of, you know, Kanye. if you can actually survive all that and make it out on the other side and then be put in a position where you can actually help young people going through a similar situation, it actually seems like it's fake until you can actually see it going on. So I was really happy to be able to do that because you can see young ladies confused. Like, this guy really opened the door. I'm talking about nice-looking young ladies. They're confused when you don't look at them, when you're standing with your wife, or when they see that you're opening the door or that you're nice to them and they're waiting for you to go in a different direction that, you know, usually a person will go and you haven't gone there with them. So, you know, working at Jackson State actually, you know, kind of feels like a ministry. Because the older you get, the more you really realize how people need to see structure. Because the normal for when we were young is abnormal now. It is scary right now, you know, to say the least.
Right. That's actually a really good point. Because that was kind of my next question, was that how was it you actually working there at the school that you done marched for and you done pledged at and, you know what I'm saying, you done took classes, you now there getting a chance to mentor to the youth, so to speak, and just actually being there to kind of help them through things. That's definitely commendable, but I'm sure it was a lot of fun as well, right?
It's an honor. Let me say this. People who are in those positions in the United States of America in 2020 are on the front lines of the people who are going to have to defend America, you know, in one form or another. Mm-hmm. You know, the people who understand democracy now are in minority. If they're in the age brackets of 30 and below, you know, people who understand the real foundations of Christianity but still claim to be Christian, you know, people who understand politics but don't understand anything about the Electoral College. It's easy to tell a group of persons who become the leader what leadership is when they never experienced being a leader. And that's what we're looking at right now. We're looking at a lot of young people who have no clue about the things that are going to be the most political things that they have to deal with in the next 10 years. So every time that you get an audience of young people who will listen to you, who will listen to you, not an audience of people that you're talking at, you know. So being a professor gave me a position where a person will come to you and say, "Miss Caldwell, how do you feel about this right. political aspect? How do you feel about this?" And before you know it, man, it became, "Ask Mr. Caldwell," you know. "Ask Mr. Caldwell."
Right.
And I was looking for that. And so that makes you change because you realize you may really be telling the next president of the United States something. And they may be hanging on the whim of what your advice is, like it's the word of God. You don't want to be the person to advise the right person the wrong thing.
Right, Right.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, my whole experience at Jackson State was wonderful. Every position that I had there, every opportunity that I had to meet somebody young that was considering coming to the school, I mean, all of that. It was all that.
That's what's up. And when you were a professor, what subject did you teach?
English, man. I taught English. Every different aspect of English. But my the most serious position was the one, well, when students came in, they weren't prepared for college yet. And I wanted them to be on par with every freshman, no matter which school they went to. And I took the most pride in that class, you know, making sure that people understand subject-verb agreement, making sure people understand the different forms of a sentence that can show up the use of the noun, you know, all those things. I just love it, you know, teaching a student how to write a research paper, which is a different class. Of course, these students didn't get that part, but I really enjoyed that aspect of teaching, too.
Right.
I wanted to get into grant writing before I left, but I couldn't figure out what I needed to do to teach that class. And it's hard to leave a position. So if you're a person like me and you find out that you fall in love with teaching grant writing, you're not going to leave teaching grant writing. I don't know any schools that have a shortage of GM teachers.
Right.
And it's not because that position is an easy position. It's because it's a life position. You take that position, you actually nurturing a person every year, showing them stuff about their body that you know they don't know because of the age that they are. And you know what can happen if they listen to you. It can change their life expectancy, you know, extend their life. So that's what I think I found with the job I have now. I'm a principal at a detention center. And oftentimes, people who are successful have two things. They have an appreciation for education and they have a respect for authority. You already know that in that position, most students don't have both of those things. Oftentimes, they will have one, but they're not going to have both of them. So I'm happy in that position because I do really feel like some of the stuff that you're saying may see through. And if it does, that little bit that does could be the difference between a God-fearing citizen who has changed his life and has now moved on and this is behind him, or a person who thinks that they were just a number. And, you know, going in there with Mr. Caldwell was just one of several experiences that they've gone through a penal system. I don't want that to be it. Just like you don't want your daughter to just consider you another dude once she realized the difference between a boy and a man, to be like, my daddy was just a man. No, my daddy was. I can't even describe what my daddy was, you know.
Right.
That's how I want her, and that's how I want the people in that school to feel about the administrator. They do different. He actually cares about us, you know. He considers what we feel. He has sympathy. I can't empathize with him, but I do have sympathy for what they're going through. But he's been keeping it real the whole time and telling us what we should expect and what we can do to offset this and that. You know, at our school, we work on relevance and relationship. And I love the staff that I have there. So I'm thankful about where I am in 2020. I'm thankful for my family. I'm thankful to God for so many things I can't tell you right now in this podcast. So I'm thankful for you giving me the opportunity, you know, to express this to whoever's listening. But that's about it on me.
So that was then my next question. Then you left Jackson State and you went to the school you at. And what was it called? Is it Henley Young?
Yeah, Henley Young is the detention center.
Okay.
Juvenile detention center.
Okay. And then you principal there.
Correct.
Okay. Have you had a most memorable experience there at your current position so far?
Every day is the most memorable experience because I learn more and more about how to be a better principal for next year. Again, this is a unique situation, and it is one that I'm proud to be a part of. But the more I find out about the system that the students go through, the more I experience them going through it, the better I'll be able to relate to them and communicate, you know, perform better. So, yeah, like I said, finding out more and more every day about the system that these young guys go through. Every day having an epiphany. I can't think of another job where I would be doing it with the kind of ramifications that I have. Making mistakes here by Mr. Caldwell could be the difference between a person changing and a person just going through another motion. I don't want to be that person that is the head of a program designed to help young people that's not doing it. So.
Right. Right. Let me give you a round of applause for that. I have to say I'm really proud of you, dog, just because I knew you were smart, and now just seeing that you a leader out here and being able to talk about it so freely and so smoothly, because that definitely seemed like that's your gig, that's your niche, explaining the things that you did, because it is very, very important that we're able to give back and reach down and pull each other up, especially the young people. And in those different situations, it's really cool. When I remember you told me that that's where you the principal, I was like, damn, that's pretty tight. I'm sure you got some good stories. And I'm sure you got some things that you're able to help people out with, but definitely making you overall a better person.
Lifting as we climb, man. You right. Just said that. Right. Lifting as we climb. Listen to this part right here. Before I left Hardin Middle School had the highest, I was there 4 years, maybe 4.5 years, had the highest number of male teachers in Jackson. I don't know if there was another school, you know, in the Tri-County area that had more male teachers than we did. And most of the male teachers that I brought in didn't have any experience. And the only thing that I charged them to do was allow me to work with you on how we need to work with these young people. The other part is, because of that, my last year at Hardin, we had the lowest number of physical altercations on the secondary level in Jackson Public School District.
Wow.
That's a Hardin Middle School is not known for not getting into fights. Right. So for me to say that there were no fights there, man, I'm really proud of those things. They were all done through relevance and relationships, communicating with people and giving them a buy-in about the control and the outcome at the school. It made a big difference. It makes a big difference no matter what you do.
Wow, that's outstanding. Let me get another round of applause for that. See, definitely see, like, you know what you're doing out here in the streets.
And out here in the real world.
So that's pretty smooth. And we're getting kind of towards the end of the interview. I got to give you another round of applause.
Thank you very much, man. I'm very happy to be here for you.
Yeah,
anything,
man,
you need.
Yeah, man. Because like I said, man, I remember, like, seeing you. And I ain't gonna lie, I remember Ernest.
That's my deuce. Yeah, that's my deuce.
I just remember that 97 line. That's what made me feel like I said, okay, I think I want to be a Q. You know what I'm saying? Like that whole thing, like it's all coming back to me. I remember.
You bringing back memories, man. We used to road trip. I'm talking about you see us there Friday at 12 o'clock. And by 4 o'clock, I'm talking about we two or three states over, somewhere wide open. Those were some great times, man. Again, I wouldn't trade them for anything.
Yeah. And I just remember that's just what, you know what I'm saying. I remember I thought y'all was, you know what I'm saying, the coolest brothers on the yard. Avery McFadden was my roommate.
Yeah.
And his family was all noobs. So I knew that's what he wanted to pledge, you know what I'm saying? So, I just remember that time. And it was a couple of them that was cool. I remember me and you and, Sed Nudley, dude looked like Drew Hill. Yeah, dude looking like Drew Hill. I remember we kicked it with him a couple of times.
Yeah, Sed, my guy, man.
Yeah, man.
He back in Indiola, catfish capital of the world.
Oh, okay. Because I know last time I was... Man, it's been a while since I've been in Jackson now, but I remember I hooked up with him when I was down there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man, that was cool, man. I'm just glad that over the years I've been able to keep up with you, you know what I'm saying, and still reach out. I'm actually going to be interviewing Louie next.
That's a good guy, man. Yeah, that's a great guy.
Yeah, in December after, like, the holidays, I'm giving myself, like, a little break. But yeah, Louie, you know what I'm saying? Louie, it was so funny because I didn't understand the whole hierarchy of the frat and how, you know, you got to holler at Louie and all the new people. Like, I didn't know that, you know what I'm saying? And I remember Louie was mad at me, boy. He was like, man, he was like, you don't know who I am and you ain't hollering at me. And I was like, well, I thought I was supposed to be hollering at old people.
You talking too much.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're talking about anymore, man. You're losing me.
I know that discretion. You know what I'm saying?
I can't hear you. What you say?
But that's what's up. But yeah, let me give you a last round of applause. Tony Caldwell.
It's for you, man. You deserve a round of applause.
I appreciate it, dog. Is there anything that you want to close with? Any way that you have some advice or some parting words out?
I'm going to say this, man. These are going to be my last words, and then you close me out. I just want to tell everyone, thank you for your time, wherever you are. Keep God first. You too can do all things through Christ who strengthens you.
Caldwell, he cut out a little early, but yeah, that's all good. As we ended the podcast, if you're interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, we'll send out your information through social media. We want to start the circle, the dollars around our craft to help build opportunities for our schools and for our communities. So contact us so we can build your business. All right, let me go ahead and give them a round of applause. For the good YE bros, shout out to you, Caldwell, again, man. I really appreciate your time. And I'll be talking to the great Louis Lindsay on December the 6th, I believe. That we're going to take a little break here for the Thanksgiving holiday. You guys, no matter if we out for the virus and you can't reach out, make sure you at least calling and reaching out to people and saying that you're thankful and that you're grateful for them. And that's all we can do right now. But hey, I'm thankful for you. I give another round of applause to the people in the chat room. Shout out to the greatest internet tag, Scarfinger Hood Rich, my twin. Shout out to September 28th. So I'm tripping. September 18th. I don't even know my own birthday. He said my man did a mic drop on the podcast. He really did. Caldwell just said out there, you know what I'm saying? It just went out there. Y'all see his little tag out there. And Antonius Caldwell, too. I think I knew Antonius. But Caldwell, that's how we refer to him. Good old Caldwell. That's how everybody remembers him. But shout out to you, B-Fresh. I see you up there saying, what's up? What's up, B-Fresh? And again, shout out to everybody in the chat room. We appreciate and we thankful for you. So you guys make sure that you hug the ones you love and be grateful for whatever you have over this next 2020 Thanksgiving holiday season. All right. We've come to the end of our podcast. Check out our website and donate what's in your heart to themarchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.